everybody.
Hey.
Thanks for coming to the second iteration of Performing Knowledge. I'm Corey Tamler, and
I'm Margaret Edwards.
So Performing Knowledge, this is the second year that it's happening. It was conceived and put together last year for the first time by Amir Farjoon and Amara Valderrama, who are both students in the PhD program in theater and performance here at the Graduate Center, collaborating with Frank Henschker, who's the director of the Segal Center. Margaret and I are also students in the same department, and so we've taken over it over the event this year and sort of made it our own and built on the structure of the event. The idea is that it will be an annual thing that aims to build kind of a community of scholars and artists and interdisciplinary folks who are working with ideas around knowledge and how we shift our relationship to knowledge, how we share it with each other, how we know, what it feels like to know something, what it feels like to share knowledge, and all of those kinds of things. So it's a very open space, and part of our idea is that knowledge isn't passive, knowing isn't passive. So we do really encourage you all as audience throughout the day, for however long or short you choose to stay, to talk to each other, to interact with each other, and to engage with the kinds of questions that these lecture performances, knowledge performances, now and earlier in the day in other spaces throughout the Grad Center have sort of brought up. And there's not time for, it's pretty rapid fire, there's not gonna be time for formal audience talk back or discussion, but we'll be encouraging you to talk with each other during the 10-minute transitions from one piece to the next, so don't feel like you have to sit and be quiet. You can talk, you can run to the bathroom, you can engage with your neighbor. And there's also an audience response station outside by the table in front of the theater, and we would love if you jot down some questions there or respond to some of the prompts as a way of also kind of like activating that in lieu of a formal talk back. And finally, there will be a reception at the very end of the night, which is some hours from now, but if you're still here at 8:30 after the last performance goes off, please join us in the green room, which is the theater department lounge. It's upstairs on the third floor, room 3111, and there will be some snacks and drinks and another good place to talk. So we don't want to talk for too much longer, but the way that this process works, we've been working on these pieces in a kind of collective dramaturgical process since the beginning of this semester. And so some of the pieces have their own dramaturg, but we also have all been in conversation throughout, and we've had several group meetings and a lot of exchange back and forth across the projects as well. And sort of we're thinking of dramaturgy. You might be most familiar with dramaturgy as a term, as something that refers to the structure of a piece, the structure of a play, if it's a term you're familiar with at all. Many of our participants were not. But we are thinking in a kind of expanded form of dramaturgy and thinking about dramaturgy as something that that really deals with the relationship between ideas and current events and ideas and the space that they're in, ideas and the body. And that's sort of where we're coming at how knowledge comes out and is expressed and is shared, sort of thinking about the dramaturgy of knowledge. So even if pieces don't have a specific dramaturg listed or attached to them in the program, they have been through some of this kind of dramaturgical process. And you'll see a lot of the strings showing it throughout the day. We're not hiding any of the transition, any of the things we're doing. These are all works in process in some way. So just embrace that and feel free to take part and be loud. And just finally, before we start, we want to say a huge thank you to the Segal Center for supporting this and being a good collaborator in this work, the theater department, the Doctoral Students Council, the Doctoral Theater Students Association, the University Student Senate, who else is it? The Sydney Cohn Chair, and all of our incredible volunteers. We've had a ton of volunteers help us out throughout the day and who are continuing to help us out. And Mike, who's up in the booth, who's making all of the tech magic happen. Thank you so much, Mike. And May, who is also part of the Segal Center and is doing amazing support and some dramaturgical work too for this whole thing. And did I forget anything? All right, all of these performances, oh, one more thing. All of these performances are about 20 minutes long and you can come and go. You don't have to stay for the whole part. Other people will probably be coming in, so that's also part of, that's part of it. But we hope you'll stay for as much as you can. And with that, do you want to introduce the first one?
Yes, so I will introduce the first knowledge performance by Tomo Imamichi, dramaturg by Elul Akinchi, and it's called 20 Minutes on a Treadmill.
Hello, welcome to 20 Minutes on a Treadmill. I'm Tomo Imamichi, and my field is environmental psychology, which studies the relationship between people and their environments. One way to do this is exploring it via challenging tasks and challenging environments. Now, this is somewhat of a challenging task, and this is somewhat of a challenging environment. Running is one thing. Running on a treadmill is another, and also, you know, facing all you wonderful people is also something quite different. And I feel that I'm a little underdressed today. Usually, you know, I would dress up a little bit more, but this is also one major thing about the transforming relationships, because over the course of the next 20 minutes, I'll be getting much warmer, even though, you know, you'll be still not so warm maybe. So, one of my projects involved looking at marathon runners and how they basically deal with the task of training for and running in a marathon. And then to look at the transformation that occur over the course of training and over the course of racing. An important part, of course, is to pace yourself. Something that I'm trying to do right now. Because as part of this performance, of course, I would like to talk about running, but I would also like to demonstrate running. And in order to do so, I set myself a goal to basically go at an 8 minute per mile pace, which would allow me to cover about 4 kilometers or 2.5 miles, which is not that much of an accomplishment, but considering that I'm also trying to give a presentation about running, I think that is a pretty decent performance. Actually, if I were on the road right now, I probably could run up to Queens. So, going back to pacing. In the beginning, the same pace will seem easy. You know, when I first set the pace, I was wondering, am I going too slow? Now, I don't think that I'm going too slow anymore. And of course, I'm only doing this for another 15 minutes. So I think I'll be able to manage. However, in the marathon, it's really key that you have to hold back at the beginning. Even though it seems slow. Then, eventually, you settle into a pace. And then, it almost happens by itself, everything. You fall into this rhythm, you know, where everything sinks, like the rhythm of the feet, the breathing, they're all going in sync, and it becomes easy. And it allows me to like look around, take in the environment. And this is actually also what most of my participants reported. But that is not the defining aspect of the marathon. Usually at around 20 miles, so the marathon, you would have another 6.2 miles to go. This is usually when it becomes challenging. This is also known as the wall. And then that pace that seemed easy suddenly becomes very challenging. And then you have to really push forward. And there's this disconnect between objective time and distance. And then the experienced time and distance. So that last 6.2 miles, or the last 10K, are usually the hardest part of the marathon, and what makes the marathon a marathon. But of course, this isn't the only aspect that I explored about running. I have also engaged in other project that could be situated in something that we might call moving methodologies or moving epistemologies, because it is through moving through the environment. Well, technically, I'm not really moving through the environment right now. I'm definitely moving, though. But anyway, by some form of embodied activity, it allows us to know more about ourselves and the world. And in a way, I'm using this performance not only to perform knowledge, but actually also to generate knowledge. Because I usually do not run on treadmills, and certainly not on a treadmill in front of people. However, in a way, I was looking forward to this experience just to get a sense of what it feels like. And it feels pretty hot. Yeah, so I'm noticing that I'm beginning to sweat. And I'm the only one in the room here, I guess. Of course, the other part that I was looking forward to was in generating some knowledge in the Q&A session that we'll have for the last 5 minutes. Because oftentimes I can get inspired by some good questions or comments. And the thing is, what better way to answer questions about running when you're running? Because you can take runners and have them talk about running, but when they are not running, how well can they talk about running? And I always notice that with myself too, because some of my best ideas happen when I'm running. And that might be in part explained by the activity of moving, but it could also be that I'm inspired by the environment as well. Oh, what happened? I might have exhausted the treadmill. And you know, I still have ways to go, but I but I'd rather have the treadmill breakdown than myself, because that was also one of the concerns that I had, is usually with the with a presentation, right? I also was somewhat concerned about not just the presentation part, but also about the running part. And then, of course, there are a couple of things that can go wrong. Sometimes it's the runner. Other times it seems to be the treadmill. But you know, well, I'm glad that it's you and not me. Yes, yes. So unfortunately, I'm not on the treadmill anymore, but because I was going to do a little sprint too, but never mind.
So questions, comments?
Yeah. They are doing a Q&A.
Yeah, actually
an actual 5-minute Q&A. So we can't ask questions. The only Q&A.
I have a question.
There was definitely a moment after you talked about falling into a rhythm with the breath in the body, mm-hmm. that I saw you fall into a rhythm. There seemed to be a moment that your body, your rhythm, the words, everything seemed to kind of, and I wondered if you felt that moment, because I definitely saw a change in your body.
Yes, there was a point as I was warming up that I was finding my rhythm. And I think that also helped my presentation. And it's quite interesting when sometimes people, when they think about things, how they like to pace up and down, for example, I think it has something to do that, you know, our thoughts sometimes come when we move. Right.
One thing that fascinates me about the transfer of embodied knowledge is that once it leaves the body, is it still knowledge? And then what is it exactly that gets passed? Or maybe a more pointed way to ask is, what knowledge were you hoping to share or to perform specifically for us today?
And I'm not sure whether I'll be answering your question, but one thing is also that sometimes when I have certain thoughts and they occur while they're running, they seem very specific to that activity and to that environment, and then once I'm somewhere else and try to rearticulate them, it seems very difficult. That there's almost sort of like that sometimes it seems that I leave my best thoughts on the road, right? And so that was something that I think your question/comment inspired, that I find is very, very key. And also now that I'm off the treadmill, you know, it doesn't seem as genuine anymore to talk about the running.
So I just sort of building off some of the other ideas that have come up, I think it's really fascinating, that idea of finding a rhythm. And yes, I think we've all had that moment of that kind of clarity that can come in physical movement. And I'm wondering if what you feel like, how much of that is psychological and how much is physiological, or whether it's perhaps impossible to...
Yes, it's very interesting that people pick up on that, because it's also, I should have mentioned that, I also think of the concept of flow by Csikszentmihalyi, and I think this sort of like experience you could also call some form of like synchronicity. And I think where those boundaries between self, body, environment seem to disappear. So I think it's contingent on that holistic experience, yes. Which in a way, a treadmill indoors is not quite the same as, you know, running outdoors, I think. Okay, so I think we are out of time. So thank you very much for running with me. And too bad for the treadmill, but all right, thank you.
take the treadmill to its grave.
Quotidian ritual and festive, thank you, festive performances where food is a key feature. And my focus is on ordinary people, the practices of ordinary people, because I don't really care about rich people. but for the purposes of today, we're going to talk about rich people. Also, colonialism is a wonderful, magical thing for my work, because it's responsible for the transnational diversification of food practices in this time period. So that means I get to have some dissertation chapters, and also that food in Europe during this time has something we call flavor. But we're not gonna talk about those things today either. Today, we're gonna talk a little bit about the early modern aristocratic kitchen, a little bit about banquets, some things that we encounter when we examine early modern recipes, and we're gonna do a little bit of cooking. So we can guess from, someone's excited. We can guess from printed books during this time period, printed books about household management, that mostly in ordinary households, women did the cooking. But these books were printed for women who had servants. So literate women were expected to read these books and then impart that knowledge onto their staff, basically. It's only in the 18th century that we have evidence of independent women actually making a living as chefs. So surprise, surprise, in noble early modern households, the chefs were mostly men. And he had loads of helpers. He was paid very well, would be given tons of meat as a bonus on holidays. And if you've ever read any early modern recipes, you know that these people really loved their meat. And the head chef would have complete freedom when it came to hiring or firing staff for his kitchen. Lords would treat these chefs really, really well so that they would remain loyal. And so it's no wonder that no one ever got poisoned, or entire households never got poisoned. So, banquets during this period were quite theatrical and could incorporate entertainments with allegorical themes and elaborate centerpieces, also music. This painting, for example, depicts a lord Unton, who is a diplomat during the Elizabethan period, and here he is presiding over a banquet while a court masque is performed for his dinner guests. The staff that worked the banquets were also very specialized and very large. For example, you would have a special meat carver who would suspend an entire bird on his carving fork and slice pieces into a plate, and it sort of looked like this. There was also a specific person who bought preserved food, specific person who bought the fruits. You had a butler who would buy the dairy and the cheese, and you had a wine steward. And then beneath all of these special guys, you would have an army of pages, servants, and water bearers. So at a typical banquet, you definitely had more people serving than people eating. Food food was also quite elaborate and spectacular at the banquets. This description, written by Vittorio Lancelotti, who was a food writer, is from a banquet at an Italian court. The first cold course consists of a veal pie in the form of a shield bearing the arms of the king. There is a sugar-glazed ham surrounded by pastry baskets with pistachio pastry stars touched up with gold and silver. Next is a roasted turkey larded with candied citron, the ends of which are gold and silver, as are the sugar pastry wings, neck, and tail. The second credenza course consists of an egg and sugar sculpture composition, with a pastry crown, garlands, marzipan rosettes, and gold and silver touches. There is also the curious invention of gelatin columns filled with little birds and fish suspended within as if alive. And probably my favorite is the third credenza course, where they had dueling marzipan Germans, as well as a little scene of dancing rustics molded out of butter. So, when it comes to presentation, the early moderns were not playing around, especially when it comes to birds. Particularly the peacock, which was often roasted whole, and then afterwards they would sew the feathers back onto the body for presentation. The other thing they did with the peacock was to use the head, wings, and feathers to decorate meat pies. That's an example of one. That's another. There are quite a few issues that come up when we're dealing with early modern recipes. For one, a lot of them look like this. This is a page in the recipe section of a commonplace book belonging to a man named John Crophill, who was a medical practitioner and a bailiff. And it's dated between 1430 and 1485. Somewhere on this page is a recipe for tarts of flesh. So do we have some early modernists in the room? Can any of you read that? All right, do we have real early modernists in the room? I'm kidding, I can't read that either because I haven't done the paleography training. But even if you could read it, you would have to wonder what some of these words even mean. And we have resources like the OED and lexicons of early modern English which help us figure out what the words are, neither of which I used for today. But I will tell you anyway what it says. It's take the flesh of capons or of hens and pork and mix with figs, raisins, and ground hard-boiled eggs. Add raw eggs, saffron, ground ginger, cinnamon, galangal, sugar, and whole cloves and maces. Then put them in a case made of thin pastry. Make another course from turkey or plover or other heavy game bird, and another course from ground meat, and eat them together. Well, menge here either means mix them together or eat them together. I'm hoping it means eat them together. Anyway, today we're not making tarts of flesh. Because we're in New York, we're gonna make some pigeon pie. But New York pigeons are fucking vicious and really hard to catch. So I brought a chicken. This recipe for pigeon pie comes from a lady named Hannah Woolley, who is an English writer, and she published books on household management. The short title of her book is The Accomplished Lady's Delight. And here she is, looking very accomplished. And here's the recipe we're gonna follow today. Truss your pigeons to bake and set them, and lard the one half of them with bacon. Mince a few sweet herbs and parsley with a little beef suet, the yolks of hard eggs, and an onion or two. Season it with salt, beaten pepper, cloves, mace, and nutmeg. Work it up with a piece of butter and stuff the bellies of the pigeons. Season them with salt and pepper as before. Take also as many lambstones seasoned as before with 6 collops of bacon, the salt drawn out. Then make a round coffin and put in your pigeons. And if you will, put in lambstones and sweetbreads and some artichoke bottoms or other dry meat to soak up the juice, because the pie will be very sweet and full of it. Then put a little white wine beaten up with the yolk of an egg when it comes out of the oven, and so serve it. We're gonna break all of that down in just a minute, but just note that we're not given any measurements. So to make a pie, we need to have a crust first. And for meat pies, early modern recipes call specifically for a paste for thin baked meats. This is a recipe for a paste for thin baked meats from Joseph Cooper, chef to King Charles I. So this is some royal crust, all right? The paste for your thin baked meats must be made with boiling liquor as followeth. When your liquor, which is water, boileth, put to every peck of flour 2 pound of butter, but let your butter boil in your liquor first. In contemporary cooking, we call this a hot water crust pastry, and it's ideal for meat pies because it doesn't leak and it doesn't get soggy. Fun fact, pastry crust was never originally intended to be tasty. It was meant to be used to carry food around in a safe little packet, like a bento box, kind of. anyway, we're not exactly told how much boiling water to use, but I'm a much better cook than I am a scholar, so I wasn't too worried about that. And 2 pounds of butter is a little bit insane. But what's more important is, what is a peck of flour? So according to Manuscript's cookbook survey, a peck of wheat flour is an understood weight of 12 or 14 pounds. However, in other recipes, a peck of flour means a volume measurement of 2 gallons, which would weigh only 8 to 10 pounds. So a peck of flour is 12 or 14 or 8 to 10 pounds. And I don't know if any of you bake, but that is a big crust. That would require quite a few chickens, never mind pigeons. So I've reduced it just a little. The thing with hot water crust pastry is that it needs to be formed while it's still warm. The top of the crust didn't make the subway ride. So it needs to be formed while it's still warm. So I made the coffin at home and I brought it with me. Now, to make things go a little bit faster, I'm gonna need your help. So I've broken down the rest of the recipe into these numbered steps. I'm gonna start with the first one, and I need you to read them aloud to me, and I'll do it as I go, okay? Okay? All right. So, number one, trust your pigeons to bake. I'll read number one. Trust your pigeons to bake and set them and lard the one half of them with bacon. So this is the chicken. I've baked it already in the name of food safety because, you know, we're in the U.S. and you guys can be fussy about that. and it's been basted in its own fat, so we don't need the bacon. Okay, next, please. Okay, so for sweet herbs, I mean, I'm not sure what that means really, but I use tarragon and chives, and I think some sage. And I used the entire egg because I'm a graduate student and I'm not throwing away good egg white. And parsley, so we're gonna mix that all up. And then, where's the butter? Here we go. A piece of butter. How much would you say is a piece of butter?
All of it.
What? All of it? All of it? There we go. This is why I bought the big spoon, because I knew someone was going to do that. All right. So we're going to mix that up. This is disgusting. okay. I think that's good. So now we're gonna stuff the belly of this chicken. Okay, that's good enough, I think. All right, next step, please.
Season them with salt and pepper as before. Take also as many lamb's bones seasoned as before, with 6 cloves of bacon, the salt drawn out, and then make a round coffin and put in your pigeons.
All right, next, please. Okay, so the juice that Hannah is worried about, lamb stones and sweetbreads can be a little bit divisive, so I decided to soak up the juices. We would use some potatoes. Now, in the early modern period, Roughly around the beginning of the 16th century, potatoes were imported from Peru and northwest Bolivia. So, but today our potatoes are imported from the exotic land of Idaho. And that's what we're gonna use to soak up the meats. So we're just gonna chop that up. All right, I think that's great. I think so. Here we go, just stuff that in there. Okay, last step, please. All right, so since we don't have a top crust right now, Margaret is gonna go make it in the back, and she's also going to stick our pie in the Segal Center's wood-fired oven. Thank you, Margaret. Don't forget to brush it with the wine and egg when it's done.
Okay.
All right, so that's gonna, it doesn't tell us how long to bake it, but my educated guess, it's gonna be like 3 to 4 hours. So we have just enough time for some Q&A. So would anybody like to ask a question? Yes?
What is a lamb stoke?
Testicles. Lamb testicles. Anybody else?
Where were artichokes from?
Well, actually, time's up. Never. You're never ever gonna know. So, thank you, thank you, thank you. Now we're not done yet because the early moderns did not send a naked pie to a party. And I really tried to get peacock for you guys today, but they didn't have them at Whole Foods. So, where is it? I brought you a crow. Trigger warning, it's about to get graphic. So if you're like the queasy type, you should probably leave. So here are the wings. There we go. Thanks. Yes. All right, so we're gonna stick a wing in here. Maybe one in here. Does that look even to you?
Yeah.
All right, great. Then where are my special tools? I have a second one. I think so. There we go. So if you're around at 8:30 today, please go up to the green room for the reception where this pie will be served. You guys were a great audience. Thank you so much.
So just as we set up for the next one, again, I encourage everybody to talk to each other in the transition, but also just a warning about the next performance that if you have sensitive hearing, this one has some very loud feedback and sort of high-pitched sounds, so anyone with sensitive hearing might not want to stay for this one. And
everyone. We are going to start in about five-ish minutes. And so if you need to run to the loo and come back, you have time. Thank you. If you'd like, we have a few minutes for questions for our early modern chef. If you would, if you have any further questions for her that didn't get answered, what was the one that, was there one that?
Is the, the pie, is like the whole chicken in a pie?
No. I demoted it. I demoted it.
I'm not sure that that's what I...
Yeah, it's too loud, huh? It's so...
Thank you.
Okay, welcome back. We are ready to begin our next knowledge performance. So I'm actually really encouraged to see all the conversation engendered, I hope, by the performances that you've seen so far. Our next knowledge performance is by Vered Engelhard and Carolyn Heiter, and it's called Attuning, Detuning, and Retuning Self.
Thank you.
Around. Well, this is our score, and we're going to pass it around so that you can look at it.
Yes.
It's plexiglass. And it's been carved.
It's a piling, I guess we piled, it's a pile of a series of scores that we did over the periods of rehearsals in which we. One would start with a certain proposition, and we would try it out, see how we feel about it, things we like, things we don't like, as far as control and improvisation, and then we would come to the next rehearsal with a suggestion about how to frame the piece more, and
different things that we could score and other things that we would leave open to interpretation. And improvisation. So the three systems of lines on the staffs are our vocal score that we were following in a cyclical repetition. And then the duration or the amount of times that we would do each system is in the grid underneath.
The grid is a series of repetitions that layers up with the different sort of variables that we start adding on to.
Yeah.
Other things in between.
What inspired you to do the piece?
Technologies of the self.
Technologies of the self. Yeah, I mean, it's a way of performing knowledge of the self. You know, oftentimes I think performance and working on a piece of somebody else is a way of understanding yourself. And when you are in collaboration together, then it becomes about exploring and understanding the different ways in relation to one another that you process and internalize and then express whatever is open to expression. And then the way that you adhere to the scored material as well.
Yeah, and the form of the duo also. The duo format is such a has such a history of, like, in therapy and you know, other forms of self-knowledge. And we're saying, like, what if composition and performance in tandem could help us achieve that sort of form in a mutual way, but also, again, self-knowledge. So there's this constant coming together and apart, I guess.
Yeah, it's a kind of collaborative creation of knowledge of the self and interpretation of knowledge of the self and then performance and performance of that and generation of that, where it's all happening kind of simultaneously in this sort of cyclical feedback loop in the way that you kind of can get trapped in that. So, any other questions? All right.
Oh.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
What are artists or contexts on this composition? How do you relate it to the work?
Other artists that do this? Paulina Oliveros.
Concepts that we relate our work to. Well, the Foucault essay, Technologies of the Self, was very foundational in the creation of this piece.
Yeah, there was a Foucault there. And then there's Pauline.
And then there's Pauline. Yeah. The different ways through which she scores her material. Yeah, you had a question.
It wasn't exactly a question. I was wondering if there was a narrative. There was a narrative that was kind of structuring your movement, because I was like, is that there was like some scenes and some, you know, like communications, and it was like, it wasn't just sound, it was more.
When you're in. Yeah, no, I mean, just a short response because we're out of time, but when you're in conversation, narratives always arise, right? It's the way you tell yourself to the other, so.
In your own
that
mind.
Was today's narrative.
That was today's narrative.
It was just today,
okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, everybody.
Just go in. Oh, I have one.
Turn the mic off before you say anything.
Welcome to How to Human. Future Form would like to thank you for joining us today here in New York City for a very special one-time only event, a training in Disruptor Mechanism Protocol, brought to us by I can't pronounce this. L something, yes. A very special training with our guest. Put your hands together, folks.
Thank you so much. New York City. New York City. Wow, I am so excited to be here with you humans today in the center of late capitalism. Oh, man. New York City, Fifth Avenue, in this former temple to commerce. Could it be any better? I am telling you. Well, don't worry about it, announcer. My name isn't pronounceable. In a little while, when humans aren't really able to use the languages that came from us living in all of these different places, and when we're not able to live in these divided ways, we're going to develop better communication devices that remove those blockages. So there is some pure sound stuff that's gonna happen, and that isn't our topic for today, but we could have a whole other session about that. If you go out in the lobby, there's some really interesting posters from Future Form about their post-linguistic technologies. Super interesting. So, but that's not what we're here for today. Today, we're talking a little bit about something, unfortunately, most of us have missed. That's how to human. How to human. We forgot to learn. You forgot to learn. We figure it out a little later. This could be you. Successful. Feeling confident in your humanoid body mind. I'm here today with a little protocol set called the disruptor mechanisms. What's a disruptor mechanism anyway? It might just be the answer you are looking for. Tell me, are you worried about systemic collapse, planetary collapse? Humans love the word planetary collapse. Well, all right. You worried? A little bit worried? Maybe about the sixth extension? It's pretty concerning. All right. Well, I have good news, but I also have bad news. And so the good news is that a protocol like the nonlinear alchemical disruptor mechanisms may be able to forestall us moving in that direction. But part of the good news is also that actually the word planetary is kind of inaccurate, because the planet will be fine. And the planet and everything on it, including some form of yourself, will emerge again as the Earth figures itself out. All of the organisms and all of the energies that are here are infinitely capable of moving itself through another system of homeostasis and restoring balance. All humans may die in the process. Don't worry. No one but you is really worried about that in the same way, but that's a capacity that you as humans have developed. It's an emotion, it's a flag, and the fact that you're having it now is part of the other good news. The good news is that those flags are here to help you. They are an evolutionary device that you have evolved to have, so that when you get here, you can start to say, hello, we may need to do something else. Unfortunately, the sort of problem is that in not really ever learning how to human, like how to use your body, which is something that in any other thing that you do, you learn. You're not a computer scientist if no one's like, here's a computer, here's how it works. But unfortunately, the form that you have, no one really ever gave you many tools to use. So, we're here today to talk just a little tiny introduction in the nonlinear alchemical disruptor mechanisms, which are an intelligence augmentation embodied cognitive fields technology from a set of books, a long set of books from the Fuchin Operating Systems Manual, specifically Volume 3, which is Humanoid Body-Mind Systems. Lots more to talk about with that today. But, wrong way. Funny. That nonlinear mind thing screws me up every time. All right, so as humans, we have incredible capacities, but most of them have not been developed. Today, we have three different types of protocol that I'm going to introduce to you that are going to help you develop some of those capacities. And even though we only have a few minutes, if you add these up, it's like that adage that humans love so much. It's kind of like water breaking away a stone. Yes, a little bit at the time, and if systematized in your daily life, these will add up to something that can create change and the ability for you to auto-evolve. The first of these is the diachronic biophilic recode. And it's great to come into this talking about water on a stone because the diachronic biophilic recode asks us to remove from ourselves what it means for us to think about humaning, verb. I want you to think what it is to stone. What is it to stone? What is it to mycology? What is it to animal? What is it to rhizome? These are the things that you want to start trying to get into your body because you have the capacity to be there. So moving into spaces where you might ask the question, how would a mushroom map this environment? How might an animal see this room? It isn't the way you see this room, but it's hard for us to not think that our understanding of it is a priori accurate. It's simply not the case. We're stuck in that mapping. Yes, the map precedes the territory. Someone in your century or so said that. So, number one, diachronic biophilic recode. And you know, plants have been trying to help you with nonlinearity for a while. A lot of your indigenous peoples also helped you out with that. The language that we used to have did not always have the causality that we are now stuck in. We're gonna get there again. Oop, forward. So, language. Language exists in that place where you, as you, which isn't mushroom or mouse, but in this humanoid body form, goes into a room and you have an experience, but you don't have an experience anymore because you have a word that's attached to that experience and you can't get rid of that word. And so you're stuck here. And so in order to move us beyond the stuckness that we're in, we've got to work with that, those words that stick us there, yeah? We are just stuck in them. We walk around and we're just in this word soup. And so, amazingly, we have a cognitive plasticity that is activated when we use different kinds of words. So if you use words different from the words you normally use, your brain actually becomes more plastic and you start to adapt and evolve. So by attempting like an active use of speculative language, you will move yourself into a future that is liminal, that doesn't yet exist. Thank you to the non-binary people and everyone using the new pronouns. They are living in a speculative space that does not yet exist, but through the use of that language, we facilitate a body that is prepared to be in that space, and then the space follows the language use. Employing this in your life on a daily basis, creating neologisms, and living in a liminal space that is semi-cognitive starts to move us out of where you're stuck. Great. Oh, all right. So all that stuckness, it also lives in the humanoid body in a way that if you don't work with agentively, none of the other stuff is gonna work because the nervous system is you've just got all this stuff in your nervous system. It comes from trauma, it comes from your experiences, and you, as a humanoid body, are different from the other things in your biome. You, other plants and animals are phylogenetic, which means that they will learn all the capacities of their body no matter what. You are not like this. You are an ontogenetic being, which means that you will only learn if given the capacity to do so. That kind of sucks. But luckily, if you know that this is the case and you remember that this is the case and you start to actually be like, hey, what are the capacities of my body? How can I control my parasympathetic nervous system? How can I know that in this moment I'm feeling fear because I learned to feel fear here? And I can tell myself that that fear is not actually something that's happening, that I should feel fear structurally, true, but that immediately I am not being chased by a bear. And so I can breathe in a certain way so that my mind can work better and my blood can work better and I can make a good decision. And so when you learn to do these things, you are more able to take on the other disruptor mechanisms and put them into place because you're not flailing around with your heart beating out of your ears, hyperventilating, which is much more convenient and easy to do. But it isn't your fault that you don't know how to do this with your body. In fact, the whole Cartesian problem that's been happening for centuries, where you were taught to separate your body from your mind, and you learn that in school, which is where you're supposed to be educated, and it's all, that's all right. You've been told to silence, you've been told to ignore it, and those are the most intelligent parts of yourself. Everything that your body is saying to you, everything it's saying to a kid saying, move around, that kid should move around. Everything it's learning will only be learned if it moves. And yet, we tell that kid to sit tight. Yeah? So, we've got to first relearn the somatics of our bodies if we're going to be able to put the other mechanisms into place. This is kind of where you're going. It's not so bad. But so, we kind of have a choice. Because, as I said before, the good news is, planet, fine. But maybe none of you will be there. It's known as the emergence. The plants, the animals, the machines, and you, but not cognitively because you haven't developed this nonlinear capacity yet, are working towards resetting. We're overpopulated. A lot of people have to die. It's not an emotional thing. It feels like one for the humanoid body mind because you have evolved to have that capacity. You are sad. No one else is sad. Not in the way that you understand sad. But maybe that sadness can help you stick around a little more. I wish I had time to stay here with you today. We could talk about this for so long. And you'll probably be thinking about it for the rest of your life. How to human is really complicated. But on a daily basis, we can bring in these little mechanisms to perhaps stick around for the next chapter. Thank you so much.
Something we're going to use for reading out loud.
performance. Hello. Yeah, here we are. So welcome back. Our next performance, knowledge performance, I should say, is by Simone Johnson. It's by Simone Johnson, dramaturg by Steven Cedars, and it is called The Oceans Are Changing.
Overlaying the ocean over me, merging with the ocean, imagining myself as the sea with all these zones and layers. Why? What am I doing here? I have nothing poetic to say. How long will it take for them all to die? When will it be over? It's happening fast, I guess. But to me, it feels like slow, drawn out changes. I can't really articulate my reasons for being drawn to the abyss. Reasons help things make sense. This is their home. Oof. In the abyss, the light gradually disappears. Life flourishes around this absence of light, and what a life. At around 100 meters deep, the Tenophores. These gelatinous creatures possess luminous organs to frighten off their enemies. Still deeper, 1,000 meters below the surface, in the ocean twilight, we find the siphonophores. These are the largest kinds of plankton. Some measure up to 50 meters. Their organs are not spread out, but grouped together. On one side, they have their stomachs. On the other, the swim bladders they use to float. Between the two, they deploy a net to trap any food which falls from the surface. Descending into the abyss is like traveling back in a biological time machine. There are maybe 2,000 species of abyss-dwelling fish, a terrifying bestiary. Viperfish that can eat things larger than themselves. Gulper eels that gobble everything which passes. Survival is tough at 1,500 meters deep. At around 3,000 meters, there is no more light. It's the kingdom of the vampire squid, a prehistoric cousin of the squid. The vampire squid has blue blood, laced with copper. Its enormous eyes detect slight variations in contrast above it, towards the surface. Its vision is entirely adapted to the shadows. Changes the abyss reasons. What am I doing here? Poetic oceans merging, imagining myself as the sea imagining itself as me. This is their home.
working through with the idea of making things make sense, but not wanting to make sense?
Yeah. First, I want to say thank you to Stephen, the dramaturg I worked with, to Leah for making these wonderful algae lamps. These are actually an algae culture in here,
wow.
In here and in here. And I, most
can
of my...
Can you take the mic and say again?
Can you hear me? I wanted to say thank you again to the dramaturg I worked with, Stephen, and to Leah, who has created these wonderful algae lamps. There's actually algae culture here, a certain strain of algae that Leah knows more about. And she actually created these with her hands. So I was just like, this is so cool. And what I was working with was I make a lot of work around water, and I tend to like want to make things that make sense and that are logical, and like I was telling people earlier, like shaping and strategizing, because I want to get a meaning across and I want it to be purposeful. And I've been exploring surrealism and magical realism as modes of research. And in surrealism, they explore like the unconscious and intervening in things making sense. So it was really hard for me because I kept trying to say, does this make sense? Is this? And I used like the eggs came from a dream I had about a bat. And I know in surrealism they use dreams. And I researched bat symbolism and like it was like rebirth, so I thought of eggs. And so it's just really interesting to kind of, I feel like I've been doing a lot of surrealist work, but I so much want to get something across. So that's what I was playing with. And this is all in the context of trying to think about the relationship of oceans and climate change. And I haven't really heard a lot of conversations about, like, I didn't realize the ocean plays such a big role in absorbing carbon. And I could go on and on, but it's gonna be a year-long project. And I'm just really grateful for all the people I worked with and for Margaret and Corey for organizing this amazing festival. So thanks.
Algae plays a role in taking carbon dioxide out of the air. So that's one thing I started looking into with algae. And then I started looking at ways to use it as a material for art making, as lamps, and as ink, because there are a lot of sustainable uses, future uses for algae people are looking into.
Well, thank you, and thank you, Simone, for your work. Thank you, everyone. We are going to take a break now. Our next part, this is the end of part one. Part two will begin at 6:30. Please come back or send your representatives at 6:30, and that half of the evening will go until about 8:30. Yes, till about 8:30, and then the reception upstairs. So. Thank you all very much. I'd like to give a big appreciative thank you to all of the knowledge performers who presented this afternoon. Thank you very much.